Remember Live Aid in 1985, that symbol of concern and generosity? Did you know that during that year, the hungriest countries in Africa gave twice as much money to us in the developed world as we gave to them? There was another famine last year. Perhaps you were one of those who took part in Red Nose Day. Did you know that before that day was over, the equivalent of all the money that Comic Relief had raised in Britain, about £12 million, had come back to the rich countries? For every day, this amount is given by the poorest to the rich as interest payments on loans that most of them never asked for or knew existed. In other words, contrary to a myth long popular in the West, it's been the poor of the world who've financed the rich, not the other way round. And this film sets out to explain why. It's also a film about war. A war you don't see on your television screens, for it's seldom news. It's been described as a silent war. Instead of soldiers dying, there are children dying. More than 500,000 in 1 year, according to the United Nations. That's more than twice the number of dead in the Gulf War. Instead of the bombing of bridges, there's the tearing down of forests and other natural resources, the bulldozing of farmland, and the running down of schools and hospitals. In many ways, it's like a colonial war. The difference is that these days, people and the resources are controlled not by viceroys and occupying armies, but by other, more sophisticated means, of which the principal weapon is debt.
There are no bullets, but it's a war in which people are dying.
War and debt are exactly the same thing, except for one point, which is that nobody needs to occupy territory today.
Well, in the 1980s, the World Bank and IMF and the US government and the British government would say to developing countries, you cut government spending, you increase exports, you privatize, or you won't get new loans.
Belt tightening is what it's called. What you do is tighten those notches that are easiest to pull. Those notches that affect children, that affect poor people, that affect people who have no power in a political system.
Part of the design of structural adjustment programs, that's what these policies are called, is to drive down real wages.
The 1980s have been a lost decade for development. The brunt has been borne by the most vulnerable groups, children or mothers with young children.
To understand the debt question, one has to understand first that what is taking place today is the greatest transfer of public wealth to private hands in the history of this earth.
The process of coercing most of humanity into debt as a means of controlling their resources, their labor, and their governments began almost half a century ago. It was not called colonialism. That was a term made defunct by World War II. There were new, hopeful euphemisms. Indeed, this was the beginning of what President Bush now calls the New World Order.
At Bretton Woods, New Hampshire, delegates from 44 allied and associate countries arrived for the opening of the United Nations Monetary and Financial Conference. Invited by President Roosevelt, they will work in the seclusion of this White Mountains resort.
Along with the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank was set up at the Bretton Woods Conference in America in 1944. The bank's aim was to finance the reconstruction of Europe, then to develop the Third World. It was decided the headquarters would be in Washington, and the president would come from the country with the largest shareholding. And of course, the United States is the largest shareholder. The World Bank operates under great secrecy and limited accountability. Every World Bank official is granted immunity from legal action anywhere in the world.
Summing up the importance of Bretton Woods, Mr. Vinson says,
ours is a mission of peace, designed to establish the economic foundations of peace on the bedrock of genuine international cooperation.
What this idealism really meant was spelt out in the charter they were signing: to promote private foreign investment by means of guarantees or loans made by private investors.
Mr. Rao, would you describe the aims of the World Bank as idealistic?
Well, the bank really is a development bank. The main focus of the bank is poverty alleviation and development of countries which are relatively low in income. I guess that's a pretty idealistic frame of mind, set of objectives. At the same time, though, the bank is a bank and has to worry about its bottom line, its standing in the markets, and is therefore necessarily a fairly hard-nosed financial institution as well.
The World Bank has always been deceptive about its role in the international economy. It attempts to portray itself as an institution looking out for the interest of not only poor countries, but for poor people within those countries. That has never been the case. The bank is pushing the interest, or promoting the interest, of countries in the first world and for an elite sector in the third world. That was true in the 1970s. It is particularly true in the 1980s.
What became known as the debt crisis got underway in the early 1980s. However, it was a minor crisis for the banks compared with the catastrophe facing the peoples of poor countries.
The banks have made a killing in the decade of the 80s. They've been crying the whole time, but not only the banks, but in fact the public institutions have received a total of over $1.3 trillion. That's 1.3 followed by about 12 zeros. And the reward that the debtor countries have received for paying their creditors $1.3 trillion in the last 10 years is to be more than 60% more in debt than they were in 1982. So if there is no change, this can go on forever, with the debtor countries remitting an average of $12 billion every month.
The world's oldest human rights organization, the Anti-Slavery Society, has declared debt a contemporary form of slavery. Nowhere is this more vividly demonstrated than here in the Philippines, where 44% of the national budget is given to paying interest charges to foreign banks, compared with just 3% for health services. Moreover, billions of dollars continue to leave this country just to meet the interest on money borrowed by the dictator Ferdinand Marcos in deals that were often secret and fraudulent. There is perhaps no greater example of the burden of debt than one notorious project in the Philippines. It sits on Bataan Peninsula and is potentially as dangerous as Chernobyl. Built less than 60 miles from the city of Manila on three earthquake faults near two live volcanoes, one of which recently erupted, this is the Bataan Nuclear Power Station. In the Philippines, it's known as the Big Scam. The scam almost certainly began here at the Whack Whack Golf Club in Manila, where Ferdinand Marcos used to play with his cousin and chief crony, Herminio Dasini. In 1974, the American company General Electric applied to build the Bataan Nuclear Power Station, but Dasini urged his pal Marcos to accept the highest bidder, the Westinghouse Company. Moreover, the deal would be underwritten by the American government through the Export-Import Bank and a clutch of private American banks. Everybody would make a buck, except the Filipino people. By 1977, President Carter had stopped the building of nuclear power plants because of their inefficiency and faulty design. But he did nothing to stop the same plants being built in third world countries like the Philippines. Moreover, the State Department, which had to approve Westinghouse's export license, knew the Bataan Power Station was to be built in an earthquake zone, but still it was encouraged to go ahead.
To make the story even more dubious, the U.S. government enters in. William Casey, later the director of the CIA, then head of the Export-Import Bank, an agency which helps U.S. businesses overseas by providing loans and loan guarantees. Casey goes to Manila. Casey comes back, recommends that the U.S. government, through this Export-Import Bank, give an initial loan. That opens the gate for all these other banks to come in and give loans, and they start building. Westinghouse at this time does the usual thing. You have delays, you have problems. The price goes up and up and up. First to $1.1 billion, finally to $2.2 billion. Some estimate that the final cost to the Philippines will be $2.6 billion. So you have a $2.6 billion fiasco that will never produce 1 watt of electricity, which now the Filipino people have to repay.
When Marcos was overthrown in 1986, President Aquino declared the Bataan power station unsafe, and it was closed forever. At the same time, her government began legal action in the United States against Westinghouse. Last year, the American judge found ample evidence of bribery. On the day before the case was due to be heard in March, it was settled out of court. Westinghouse agreed to pay the Philippines $100 million. But remarkably, the Aquino government agreed to give Westinghouse $400 million just to make the power station work, regardless of its position in an earthquake zone. And this $400 million will be borrowed from the same American Export-Import Bank and will have to be repaid by the Filipino people, most of whom live in poverty.
Why should the Filipino people now, having got rid of the dictator Marcos, repay money that he got from the World Bank, much of it which he and his cronies pocketed?
Well, I don't know how much of the World Bank money he pocketed. There are a lot of procedures.
Well, we know he pocketed quite a bit, you would agree.
Of the World Bank money, I would disagree. Mm. There are a lot of procedures in place to ensure that the disbursements of World Bank monies are for projects which are well monitored are against purchases which are again well monitored.
The World Bank and IMF that pride themselves in being institutions that are helping deal with the debt crisis were being used by a third world president actually for his own internal economic gain, in that it was allowing him to continue to service commercial bank debts without getting into trouble, continue to get new loans in, from which again he would take whatever, 1% or 1.5%. and continue to enrich himself.
Finally, may I turn to that other slavery, our $26 billion foreign debt. I have said that we shall honor it, yet half our export earnings, $2 billion out of $4 billion, which is all we can earn in the restrictive markets of the world, must go to pay just the interest on a debt whose benefit the Filipino people never received.
When Cory Aquino was swept to power, she described the Philippines as a land of broken promises. Her promise to the Filipino people was that they would be the beneficiaries of their civilized uprising against Marcos. "I will vigorously renegotiate," she said, "the terms of our foreign debt." But in the end, she gave priority to paying off the banks. Poverty now stands at 70% of the population, a rise of more than 10% since she came to power. A Big Mac is not for the poor. As the debt is paid back at a rate of more than $6 million a day, the rich, like the elites in all debtor nations, increasingly rely on private armies to protect their shopping malls, their homes, and their interests. According to Amnesty International, political killings carried out by the government and government-backed forces in violation of the law have become the most serious human rights problem in the Philippines. This is Eddie. He's 32, a bright, responsible, decent man faced with a clear choice. He can sift through rubbish, picking out bits of glass, tin and plastic in order to make a living, or he can let his family starve. They live in a place known to all Manila as Smokey Mountain. The stench and the ashen rain are constant here. There are two sounds that dominate, the sound of dump trucks and of children coughing as they descend on the newly delivered rubbish like birds waiting for the clod to turn. More than 20,000 people live on and in the rubbish of Smokey Mountain. They are the face workers of modern poverty, and their lives are a metaphor for the condition of peoples in many countries whose impoverishment in the 1990s accelerates as the debt of poor nations grows and grows. The way these people have to live has much to do with decisions taken far from the poverty and the stench. They are the products of structural adjustment, a modern jargon term with old-fashioned meaning. It means an economy reshaped and controlled by outside forces so that foreign debt can be paid back and foreign investment and export production made attractive by cheap labor. So cheap that these people are forced to scavenge here. It's an economy whose unprofitable public services, like schools, hospitals, and clean running water, are expendable.
How long have you lived here, Eddie?
Almost 13 years.
So you thought by coming to Manila you'd get work. That's what everybody in the countryside thought at that time. So you had to come to Smokey Mountain.
Yeah, so I decided to come to Smokey Mountain because if I did not work in every day, I'd not eat.
This is Eddie's structurally adjusted neighborhood, which periodically gets bulldozed to make room for more rubbish. In order to eat and feed their family, Eddie and his wife Teresita must work at least 12 hours a day to make just over £2. This pays for two basic meals, mostly rice, for them and their four children. When Teresita was about to have baby Grace, Eddie paid for a midwife by selling wood that was to be the roof over their second room. Every child born on Smokey Mountain stands a good chance of not living to the age of five.
Almost 30% of the children here, the problem is the diarrhea and pneumonia and malnutrition.
30% pneumonia and diarrhea and malnutrition.
This is not surprising, as they live without clean water and sanitation, nor can they afford doctors and clinics, as social services are cut back and privatized.
If you have no money, sometimes the children were died.
So that's so unless you can buy the medicine, it's quite possible that children will die.
We try to do our best.
That's a very, very difficult situation.
This is my house. My wife, this
Teresita.
Is my children, and what, the other two was outside.
Hello, what's his name?
She's Junior, Eduardo Junior.
Oh,
yeah,
very nice.
He's the only boy.
All around here, the one thing that strikes me, there is very romantic music playing. Are you both romantic? The two of you? Are you romantic people?
Yeah. Because we have no almost six children if they are romantic.
Thank you.
So, Sita, what happened when your last baby was born?
There was a really bad storm that night, and then we were here in the house, and then I was holding the baby and rocking her, and the storm was raging, and the other children were squashed here beside us, so the rain wouldn't get to them. You see, it gets flooded here. We've never had the money to fix the roof. It leaks all the time. I was worried that if they got wet, they'd get sick, like my other children who died. See, my eldest was 4 years old when he got sick. He got sick here in this house. I didn't know what to do. You see, living here in these filthy conditions, the smoke and everything, he got really bad diarrhea. Well, it killed him. That time, they were demolishing the houses here. It must have been 1982. Yes, 82, when the demolitions happened. I had a row with the demolition men. I pleaded, please, wait until I buried my child before you demolish my house. Can you imagine? You have a dead boy in your house and they want to demolish it.
Elizabeth died from malnutrition because there a worm get outside of her mouth.
She had worms, yeah. that came out of her mouth.
Mm-hmm. So they bring them to the hospital because on that time I'm in my work. So when I go to the hospital, I saw that my baby was dead already.
We did calculations to show how many children in the Philippines die because of the way the debt crisis has been managed. And we calculated how much the health budget had been cut. And on the basis of that, came up with a figure that one Filipino child dies every hour because of the increase in debt service payments.
Debt to most people seems to be a matter for the financial pages, for the banks and the governments. But in fact, debt has been, in the past decade, the largest new contributing factor to hunger and to misery.
The Philippines spends almost half its national budget paying just the interest on debt owed to foreign banks. These are homeless children on the streets of Manila, but they could be anywhere in the indebted world. Here, the problem of homelessness has become so serious that this police unit does nothing but round up children and try to find institutions that will take them. But they are few, and most of the children come back to the streets. Wow. Lieutenant Siochi and his men run their unit partly out of their own pockets. All of them have to moonlight as taxi drivers and ice cream vendors, but these jobs are increasingly rare. The National Economic Development Authority estimated that as a result of IMF policies, 500,000 workers will lose their jobs in the Philippines this year. That means more children on the streets.
where do these children come from, the children that we've seen on the streets?
Some of them come from the provinces and very low-income families here in Manila.
So they come to Manila with their families?
Yes, yes. And they found that Manila is not a haven as they think, not now. Before, they can get easy jobs here, but now no more.
The children that are sleeping alone, have they lost contact with their families?
Most of them. Their parents have abandoned them already because of these hardships. They cannot feed them anymore.
Are they very vulnerable to drugs?
Some of them.
I noticed some of them look like they had been using drugs.
Yes, yes, yeah. That's true.
And prostitution?
They are, as we call them, walking doll.
Walking doll?
Yeah, because they are already prostitutes. Some of them are sick and hungry. But once we brought them to this non-governmental institution like the center, no? We brought them there. Those social workers take care of them. And we find it heartening. The government is bankrupt. The government is even paying for international debts obtained by the last administration of Marcos.
So you're saying that's the pressure on the society, that the government has to pay so much. Its resources are going one way, and it hasn't any money left to do something about the homelessness.
Yes, we are supposed to pay from the International Monetary Fund. Too many debts.
This 15-day-old baby was born on the streets. The parents are teenagers and were themselves street children and products of the debt era. The mother was born in the year the World Bank declared the Philippines a special case for development and lent the dictator Marcos more than $4 billion. During their lifetime, the number of people in poverty has risen by almost a quarter of the population.
The Philippines is getting worse now. Only God maybe can save these Philippines.
There's no reason why this country should be poor.
Yeah, there's no reason. We are very rich in natural resources. We can stand by our own.
This is a country abundant in food, but food does not pay back the debt or encourage foreign investors. And so agriculture and a whole way of life is being structurally adjusted. This is the Calabazon super project, turning food-growing land into factories for export production. Funded largely by Japan, it is the kind of so-called reform demanded by the IMF. The new factories will produce new revenue and profits for foreigners. They will also produce new debt for the Philippines.
Calabazon typifies the kind of development strategy which only brings ruin to the third world, because such a strategy is premised, for example, on massive development, so-called development, massive exploitation of the environment, change in people's way of life, taking land from the people and the peasants to be able to convert these into so-called industrial zones with the problems of pollution and everything. And usually, this development strategy is fueled by debt, fueled by foreign investment.
The caliper's own project will destroy food-growing land on which an estimated 8 million people depend. The farmers have been given little or no notice, and compensation generally has been meagre. In the meantime, many of them will end up on the streets of Manila, homeless. Japanese, American, and other foreign-owned factories will rise on the paddies and fields.
This is the kind of development that must be put to a stop, because it is not development at all. It is destruction of the environment, it is impoverishing of the people, and it is pushing the country into a debt trap.
There is a terrible irony here. While the rich world lectures the poor on the importance of preserving the environment, the IMF and the banks tell the people of the Philippines they must export in order to pay off the debt. But all they have is their fragile earth, its minerals and forests. So the earth must pay the debt. The mangroves are plundered, the coral reefs torn up so that chunks of it and tropical fish can be sold to America, and the destruction of the great rainforests is almost complete. This is the final result. In 1991, a typhoon left 6,000 people dead and 43,000 homeless in an area where previously the forests had protected the people from floods and mudslides. By the year 2000, hardly a tree will be left standing. Forests as big as Denmark have been wiped out, bringing to an end one of the richest ecosystems on the planet, the home of thousands of species of plants and animals.
The environment is probably the major victim, next to human beings, of the debt crisis, if only because countries are obliged to cash in their resources. They must cut down their forests. They must dig up their minerals and ruin their land, producing cash crops so that they can earn enough hard currency to keep on paying the debt. There is an almost perfect correlation between the top debtors and the top deforesters. It's a striking correlation.
In the Amazon area of Brazil, in Ghana, in Costa Rica, roads are built, incentives are given to allow the extraction of these resources. Particularly now with structural adjustment, there is a program in place in most countries of deregulation, that is deregulating control of these industries. And also, there is not enough money in the budget to oversee these activities. So you're seeing the wholesale raping of these environments.
At their 1991 conference, the World Bank and IMF appeared to be making a special commitment to the environment. What would your response be to that?
If the World Bank is now saying how green it is, what it's not saying is how much it has destroyed through its policies. It's not enough to put a green tail on a very large, monstrous dog, which is destroying the environment, and that is what debt is doing.
Welcome to the World Bank and International Monetary Fund conference in Bangkok. The aim of the conference is, and I quote, to find ways of eradicating poverty all over the world. Alas, there are contradictions. You see, most of the delegates are bankers. Now, this is not to suggest that bankers don't care about poor people. It's just that some things are hard to explain, such as why officials of the World Bank spend, in their pursuit of solutions for the poor, an estimated $45 million a year flying first class and staying in five-star hotels. And why at this conference, chefs have been flown in, especially from Paris, to a country where children still die from malnutrition, and why they need to be shadowed by more doctors than most people in Southeast Asia see in a lifetime. Fortunately, the people who can best advise them on how to eradicate poverty are just across the road. However, the bankers can't see them because a wall was put up to hide the poor people during the conference. The people responded by painting the wall in bright colors in order to attract attention. No doubt worried that the delegates might spot the odd poor person, the government then had buses parked in front of the wall. Most of these people are street traders, but in the build-up to the conference, hundreds of vendors were almost literally swept from the streets of Bangkok. So here they sit with their empty carts, hidden from view, unable to earn a living until a conference discussing poverty moves on. For years, one of the landmarks of Bangkok, as you drove in from the airport, was a community of people living beside these railway tracks. 500 families lived here. A few weeks before the World Bank conference began, everything was bulldozed. Homes, a kindergarten, a makeshift school.
When it was known that the World Bank meeting was going to be held here, they were advised that they would have to leave. There was a quote in the newspaper, the English translation of which was, one official said they were an eyesore. Now that word went around, people didn't forget that word. A lot of the slum people said, look, we're not an eyesore. These are the homes of poor workers. But unfortunately it was regarded as such. They're very untidy, they're very scrappy looking homes. And there was some kind of thinking at the time that they should be tidied up. And either you build a wall around them or you move them away. And that's what happened.
So the bankers, the delegates of the conference, wouldn't see them, is that?
I think that was the idea, yes.
They weren't rehoused. They rebuilt their homes 500 yards further down the line, where they couldn't be seen from the road. An added effect for many of them was unemployment, because in the move they couldn't turn up for work and lost their jobs. One of the reasons the World Bank and IMF chose Bangkok for their conference was that they regard Thailand as an economic model for other countries to follow.
Good morning, welcome to Panhe, everyone.
Good morning, welcome to Regent Hotel.
This conference seems to us to be what used to be called a media event. To others, it looks like a binge. It's difficult for some people standing back to understand that this conference has to do with helping people who are needy, who are poor.
Well, I've been here almost a week and I've spent most of my time in meetings, meetings with government officials. We had meetings of our various committees to discuss policies, and I don't come away with the perspective that you have at all. This meeting has provided ministers and governors from all of our members to come and exchange views on how they see the world economy evolving and the needs of developing countries. And I think the thing that has stood out in this in this annual meeting of the IMF and the World Bank, and that is a pretty strong consensus on what kind of policies work and what kind of policies do not work. I have a sense, I see a sense and hear a sense of optimism about that here that did not exist in the early 1980s. I feel that you're reflecting experiences and events of a period in the past, and that much has happened particularly in recent years in many countries where they have been able to achieve some success in their economic performance.
I don't agree. It is now 1991. Debt is still a major problem for countries like the Philippines and perhaps 70 other third world countries who are still in the debt trap. From the point of view of the banks, the debt crisis is already over because they are covered by loan loss reserves. From the point of view of multilaterals, the debt crisis is over because there has not been any interruption in payments to them. They have set their conditionalities, they have set their terms, and they have made sure that they will be paid continuously. So from their point of view, the debt crisis is over because they are safe. The multilaterals are safe, the commercial banks are safe, the bilateral countries are safe, but the people of the third world are not safe because they continue to pay a debt.
Debt was crucial to the pressure exerted by the United States in building the so-called coalition against Saddam Hussein. The Gulf War was said to be the dawn of a new age for the United Nations, the New World Order in action. In fact, the United States was able to tailor the UN Security Council to its war plans by using debt in the international banks. Egypt was told that if it joined the coalition, $14 billion would be wiped off its national debt. And Iran, reported Reuters, was rewarded for its support of the United States with its first loan from the World Bank since the 1979 Islamic Revolution. The day before the ground attack, the bank approved a loan to Iran of $250 million. And China received the first World Bank loan since the Tiananmen Square massacre, just 1 week after the Chinese foreign minister met President Bush at the White House. Outside the bank, Syria was promised a billion-dollar arms deal brokered by Washington, and a photo opportunity was arranged with President Bush. An international terrorist was suddenly an old friend. The vote of the non-permanent members of the Security Council was critical. Minutes after Yemen voted against the resolution to go to war, a senior American diplomat was instructed to tell the Yemeni ambassador, "That was the most expensive no vote you ever cast," meaning that $70 million in American aid to one of the poorest countries in the world would be stopped. The use of debt in bribing the coalition was nothing new. Manipulation of the World Bank was documented in the early 1980s in a secret U.S. Treasury report. The United States, says the report, is capable and willing to pursue important policy objectives in the banks by exercising the financial and political leverage at our disposal. In other words, the US is able to impose its will on the World Bank. Britain's influence on the international banks is small compared with the United States, but British high street banks are deeply involved in third world debt. In 1 year, 1990, poor countries transferred more than £6 billion net to British banks. On top of this, the banks were allowed tax relief on making provision for so-called doubtful loans. From 1987 to 1990, this tax relief amounted to £1.6 billion, the equivalent of 10 times what the British public gives in charitable donations to the Third World. We invited all the high street banks to be interviewed about this. All of them refused. So we asked the Bankers Association to explain it, and they said it was nothing unusual. As in all business debt, they said, the tax relief would have to be paid back when the principal loan was paid back. In the meantime, the banks can keep the tax relief and still demand interest payments. And this constant demand is true also of the IMF and the World Bank.
Clearly, one is not repaying money that was one is not borrowed in the first place. So whatever is now being repaid was in fact disbursed the other way some years earlier. And what you're observing, in fact, is first of all the interest that is payable on borrowings, which I think any person with a mortgage would readily recognize. You're observing a lot of rescheduling of these payments. All of the severely indebted countries that you are concerned about have in fact rescheduled, i.e. postponed their payments very significantly to many of their creditors. And what you're observing also is the payment of interest on the monies that are in their use.
In 1991, Prime Minister John Major announced that the British government would wipe out the debts of certain African countries. The gesture was important, but accounts for only 1% of worldwide debt. To end the tyranny of debt altogether and to fight poverty, there has to be radically new thinking. The only solution for most poor countries is that their debt is written off completely. At the very least, their loan repayments are channeled back into genuine development that puts food growing, health and education before so-called economic growth. The banks are not solely to blame for the debt and poverty, but it's not possible for them to look after the interests of the rich world and the poor world at the same time. The World Bank and the IMF should be abolished and replaced by a real development agency that is non-profit making and entirely free of political strings and can help nations develop on their terms, meeting their needs. In Britain in the 1990s, the Third World and the ravages of debt have come home as the rich have got richer and the poor poorer. No other country in Europe has seen such a dramatic rise in poverty. One in five British children now lives in poverty. Of course, during the 1980s, a large number of people appeared to be doing well by living off debt. They had jobs and small businesses. But now jobs are being lost and businesses are going bankrupt and 80,000 homes are being repossessed a year. Many of these people are now joining the homeless. And as in the Third World, poverty kills, says Professor Peter Townsend, a world authority. That is not a political or social comment, he said, but a scientific fact.
The debt crisis started in 1982, and if it goes on for another 10 years, think of all those 18-year-olds who will not have known anything in their entire lives but austerity. And those kids are extraordinarily frustrated and extraordinarily angry.
The human consequences of debt have been a largely unwritten story. And if you miss the chance when a child is 1 or 5 or 10 to provide the basic nutrition, the early education, a home with love and care, there will be consequences when that child is an adult. And I fear we will see those consequences and have to live with them 20, 30, 40 years from now.
Given that most countries do have enough resources to provide for their people, why should they have to tolerate a system that forces parents to watch their children die slowly, like the children of Eddie and Teresita in the Philippines? Indeed, why should the burden of debt fall to those least responsible for it? At the other end of the scale, why should British high street banks get tax relief of more than £1 billion just in case loans are not paid back? That amount of money would immunize 400 million children against preventable disease. Above all, why should the lives of ordinary people be controlled by a few who are themselves unaccountable and whose decisions and judgments are dictated by a belief that economics is meant not to serve people, but as some kind of holy writ requiring regular offerings, even blood sacrifices, to a god called the bottom line? The debt of all poor countries accounts for less than 5% of the loans of commercial banks. If the debt was cancelled unconditionally, the banks would hardly know the difference. If it's not cancelled, the scenes shown in this film will endure, and people may take it no more, and perhaps the debt war will no longer be silent. Is that the kind of world we are to give those children who reach the 21st century?
Going overseas to buy changes that will never come. Dollar backed contra spill the blood of the people in small nation. We won't leave alone. Meanwhile, in the corporate boardroom, they talk about the day. if it could be paid. But money borrowed and loaned for goods you can't eat and buildings you can't live in and trinkets you can't wear. It is a debt not owed by the people.
An action pack, The World in Our Hands, has been produced in association with Oracle Corporation UK Limited, which gives more information on third world debt, environmental damage and poverty. For your copy of the pack, send a cheque or postal order for £2 made payable to Central Television to War by Other Means, Box 96, Birmingham B1 2JL.